At 6 o'clock, I want to call to order the April 11th meeting of the Winnfield City Council. Would everybody please stand for the invocation and remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance? Have Pastor Kamel Hams here to lead us in our invocation tonight.
Let's pray. Eternal Father, we thank you for your many blessings. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the opportunity we have, oh God, to live this gift called life. We ask that God for continued blessing upon this city, our leadership of this city, our mayor, our council. We ask that God for spirit of direction tonight, fellowship, community, and cooperation. God, help us to understand that at the end of the day, it's not about right or wrong. It's about giving you glory. Help us to understand, Father, what we're in this life for, to honor you and give you glory. Father, this week we're so honored and blessed because we get to celebrate the greatest gift, eternal life from your Son, as he rose from the dead on that third day morning. Help us to be mindful of what's been done for us and what we can do for you in return. We thank you and praise you for it now. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of our country.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any changes or amendments to the agenda? If not, then we will proceed with the agenda as posted 24 hours earlier. The next item on the agenda is the guest and audience participation tonight. I think we have several folks here that want to address the council. Mr. Smith?
Hill.
Hart?
Hill.
Hill, I'm sorry. Danny Hill. I'll recognize you first.
Hey, I'm Louis. My name is Danny Hill. I work for State Highway Department as a supervisor. What I want to talk about was me and some of my neighbors that have a problem with another neighbor that bought a rooster. And it's going at 3 and 3:30 in the morning, waking us up every morning. And I don't know anything we do about it. Take the rooster back or something. I went and talked to the guy and tried to pay him to take it back, but he said, no, he wants to keep it. And I said, well, it's a little leg on the side, 80-something years old. Living 60-something. I stay in Laura Heights, it used to be in Laura Heights, not on the hands. But he don't want to get rid of the rooster. And every morning, she's a school teacher, she go to work, she, I go to work, she, and they didn't get done, but I stay out more. What I want to know is anything on the book, or can we both put something on the book? It's beginning to be a nuisance. It's disturbing the peace. And he crows from 3 in the morning, all the neighbors.
There's a rooster.
It says to keep with any animal, bird, or fowl by causing frequent, loud, continued noise or disrupting the comfort or repose of any person is hereby declared to be a violation of this ordinance. And the fine. It's the same thing as it is on all the other stuff in the city.
Like a
4-acre? Yeah, it can be up to $500.
And who does the fine?
Well, I mean, the city police. Can write a ticket. Yeah, they can write a ticket.
The police department can write a ticket.
That's just.
And that's the first offense. And then if there's a second offense,
it's
something
else. Don't say that. It's just a. It period is illegal. I mean, it's not legal.
Okay, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hill had made several complaints about this on yesterday, something like that. And I had called myself to City Hall and spoke with the clerk on the same incident that was going on with the rooster. she said, animal control is going to be involved, is going to look into it, you know, and take care of the situation, whatever like that.
Okay, but as far as the way I read.
That was not me that you spoke with, who was that you spoke with?
I spoke with Ms. Katrina.
Okay.
And she, saying that, she tried to go with the animal control.
Okay, and, the, under animal control, and I think she called, or we called, Camilla Gardner, the animal control officer, and according to, under the animal control ordinances, you can have chickens in the city limits. And so I guess that was the question.
This was that we.
This would be a noise.
Noise ordinance.
It would be a noise ordinance. So,
Can we put on the agenda, vote to pass it about 3 weeks?
We already got some of that place in the noise.
Yes, she just looked at the wrong ordinance. Yes, you can have chickens, but you can't have one that grows on the lawn. That goes to a different ordinance.
Disturbing the peace, and that would come under, like you said, to the police department as far as disturbing the peace.
Just like loud cars.
So y'all, the police department could go give the person maybe a warning, and then if he doesn't remove the bird, then they would have to write a ticket for, disturbing the peace.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, good evening.
You too.
Okay, next, got guests and audience participation. Is anyone else?
Yes, I'd like to.
Mr. Dudley?
Next, Kevin Dudley, 507 West 24th Street, Winnfield, Louisiana. And I've been over there several times, but everybody know about the loud music. We have never came to a conclusion on this thing yet. I heard the city attorney addressing the loud noise in terms of the rooster. He talked as if it's a simple thing, just write a ticket. Well, we're talking about since 2012, we've been working on that. We had a meeting 3 years ago coming up next month. Ms. Junkin, Ms. Dimery, and the city attorney. He's supposed to send a letter to the attorney general. Coming up 3 years, he hadn't had a response. And you had a response, Ms. Junkin, from the city attorney?
We did receive a response.
We did receive a response from the state attorney general.
In terms of whether we could write a ticket without the meter? Because that won't be removed. Ms. Junkin, do you remember our meeting?
I remember every bit of that conversation.
Okay, have you had a response in terms of?
I have from the city attorney. He got one from the attorney general's office. I don't.
Stating what? Because the last time I was here, about a year ago, nobody had a, and the city attorney said that maybe because of the change of administration, it was slow about getting back to us.
What was it?
I don't remember exactly. Administration took place, but I don't remember the.
I do remember that we had the conversation about that since that meeting a year ago.
Where do we stand?
Where do we stand, Herman?
I don't remember all of it. I don't remember.
I remember something.
Well, you know what I think, Mr. Cassett. Like I told Ms. Junkin at that meeting, Mr. Cassett is not concerned with the disturbance of the people that loud music in black neighborhoods. He's plainly made that clear. Because anytime a city attorney is representing a city and he refers to the attorney general and it takes 3 years to get a response back, and the loud music, it continues to happen. No tickets are being written. Nobody's being fined. The people are steady being disturbed on a regular basis. I call up 20 times a week. I have arguments with the dispatcher, with patrolmen come out there, act like they don't hear it. This is absolutely ridiculous. This is the worst situation in the black community. And I guarantee you, Mr. Emmer and Ms. Dimery and Mr. Hampton, verify what I'm saying. This is the biggest problem the black community have. People riding through our neighborhood with the loudest noise you could ever hear. I don't call it music. I just call it racket noise. And people cannot live. You cannot live like that. And I just wonder, when is this going to stop? Because there's no way you can let crime fester without some kind of punishment. Crime will not cease unless you punish people for the crime. And I
And if you don't write a ticket, like he was saying about the rooster, if you don't write a ticket, people are not going to stop breaking the law. So y'all as councilmen, the mayor and the city, this is on y'all. This is on y'all to stop this. Now, so I'm wondering now, tonight, do I have to come up here again? Will I ever come up here again about this? Or can we nip this in the bud tonight? Because all it is catching somebody breaking the law. And the media is a red herring, because the media doesn't save any information. It doesn't print out any information. So when the policeman comes to trial with the offender, the judge has to rely on the police officer's testimony. We talked about that in the media.
Yes, I remember.
So the media is a red herring. Forget the media. If it's too loud, people need to be punished for it. There's no reason for people, the parking lot at the city center. They'll sit out there on the parking lot. I know we got laws against loitering. They'll sit out there 5 or 6 cars, trunk up, hood up, and just blast it. It's ridiculous.
I'm introducing an ordinance tonight about that. So.
Well, all I'm asking, the mayor and the council, did y'all respond to this? And let's stop this. Because there's no reason. There's no reason for it. Y'all wouldn't want to live under these conditions.
I get it every now and then. I hear it. And it's not, it's not all the time.
I know, but it gives me a taste of what it must be. I guarantee you, they go up 27th Street up that hill, mm-hmm. after that convenience store, mm-hmm. and sit out there in that park, and they come right back to it, and it's just a constant basis. Constant basis. Awesome. So that's really all I wanted, but I hope this is the last time I have to come in.
Right. Thank you, Mr.
Thank y'all.
Mr. Hickam. We have anyone else, some guests and audience participation tonight? Okay, we'll move on from that. Okay, under old business action items, we have number one, Mr. Hams.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, it's the condemnation of the Olivia Johnson estate. It's on Martin Luther King, and we had previously gave the assert the notice and gave them 3 months to do something about it. And I think it's been about a year since then, and still in the same condition, it's not worse. Now I'm just going to make a motion that we go ahead and stay on that property.
Is it? I'll have to ask. I think it's already condemned, isn't it?
Well, it's condemned.
It was tabled because of we gave an opportunity right. to do something.
Right.
Okay. So.
You can carry out to bring it down.
Okay. All right, so you're making that a form of a motion.
I made that a form of a motion.
Motion to tear down previously condemned property of Olivia Johnson Estate on Martin Luther King. So do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second by Junkin. Any discussion? Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, old business non-action. We have none. Under new business action items, first one is to accept the minutes from the February 14th 2017 regular meeting. I have a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Motion from Miller. I have a second. Second from Demery. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Number two is to accept the minutes from the March 14th regular meeting of the Winnfield City Council. I have a motion from Demery. Second from Junkin. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Accept the minutes from the March 24th, 2017 special meeting.
So, Mayor.
Hold on. I got a question for you, Mr. Mills. On that, particular meeting there, it was some information on there that said where we amended the budget, but it was kind of misleading because it just said the 16-17 budget, but it was particular items in there that was amended, and it wasn't the whole budget, and the way it stipulated, you would think that it's the entire budget.
I think it said the general fund.
Yeah, it says the proposed amendment one to the general fund, 2016-17, which the budget at the top that we amended said proposed amendment one.
Okay, so we left out like the electric department.
We didn't amend.
You're right, we didn't amend that, so I'd say, but just to look at it, you wouldn't.
Yeah, it says proposed amendment one to the general fund, the utility fund, the sales tax fund were not amended.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure it's clear on that.
Okay. So we have a motion by Miller and a second by Edwards. All in favor, say aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. Number four, accept the minutes from the March 29th special meeting. Winnfield City Council.
So moved.
Motion by Miller.
Second.
Second by Junkin. All in favor, say aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Number five is introduction of ordinance 6 of 2017 to delete section 19.9. Mr. Miller.
An ordinance to repeal section 19.9 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Winnfield, Louisiana to provide for related matters and to provide an effective date therefore, and consider this introduced.
Okay, thank you. Number six. Introduction of Ordinance 7, 2017, amending Article 2, Playground and Recreation Board, Section 15-16. Mr. Edwards.
An ordinance to amend Section 15-16 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Winnfield, Louisiana, to provide for members of the Playground and Recreation Board, matters related thereof, and providing effective date. This is for us to, we have a five-member board in the city, and if we're going to do business and that's the parish for help, all of that's going to, we have one more member to that committee from the parish. We can select that member.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Can I want to make sure we can clear on that. We should have an A after that section 15-16 or 15-16.
It is. It's
15-16.
Okay.
Okay. I'll make sure I have a typo or something.
Okay. Number seven is an introduction of Ordinance 8 of 2017, the regulation of parking at the Civic Center. Junkin.
This is an ordinance to amend the Code of Ordinances of the City of Winnfield, Louisiana, to add thereto Section 13-53 to regulate parking in the parking spaces provided for the Winnfield Civic Center, to provide a penalty for violation thereof, and to provide an effective date therefore.
Thank you.
This is regulation as far as a parking, but I guess it's going back.
It's going to be part of the loitering, and all that will be written in from what I understand from Mr. Cassette. When we get the ordinance written, it'll have
Mr. W's
complaints about the people loitering and playing loud music out in that parking lot. It's going to give teeth to the police officers to go out and write tickets for that.
So this is without the meter?
It's going to start out.
No, they can't be doing their
parking
anyway.
Out there yeah. Except during an event and only by participants of the event. If somebody can't just come out there and park and start playing music, that kind of thing.
And even at the event, they can't just come out and hang out in their cars. No, they have to either be getting in the car and leaving or getting out of their car and going into the building.
May I respond? May I respond just for one second? And this is going to sound crazy. This is going to sound kind of like ugly. But white people have stuff out there all the time. Nobody's in the parking lot. All this happens when black folks have events out there. And I'm just telling the truth, okay? I'm just being honest. We don't have no problem. I don't care what white people have out there. There's no problem in the parking lot. Soon as somebody even have a wedding or something out there, black, they sit out there in the parking lot, they blow their parking lot up. I'm just being honest.
Okay, thank you for your comment.
This is the problem.
This is a reaction to something the police chief has asked us to work on also, so.
And I appreciate it.
It's gonna basically, but it applies to everybody, don't just apply to black and white, whatever, whatever.
I'm not saying it doesn't apply to anybody, I'm just telling what the problem is. I live right in front of the playground, Mr. Cassett, I know what the problem is.
Okay, Mr. Dudley.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, number eight is the condemnation of the Anthony Autry property.
Okay, we've heard notice on Mr. Autry on March the 27th, if the board intends that, we'll file this with the clerk. Y'all have seen the picture, they all familiar with the property, I've got pictures, we're gonna look at it, I file that with the clerk also. And have it parked down on Maple Street. Number one, I need you to pass a motion, a resolution, and declare it as a danger to health and safety.
So moved.
Second.
They have a motion to declare the Anthony Autry property on Maple Street a danger to safety and health by Miller, and I have a second by Junkin. Is that all a resolution needs to state?
It's all good, it's gonna be clear. To do it the way we're doing it, the 24-hour thing coming.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Now, as far as the timeframe, I'm gonna say you give 24 hours and you go in there and demolish it. After he gets served with the notice of the judge, which the mayor will sign in just a minute.
So you'll let us know when he's.
Yeah, so he'll get served tomorrow, because we can send him to go serve it tomorrow.
So that's the minimum timeframe, 24 hours after he's served?
Right, because that's why you have to do his motion. I mean, you have to have the resolution before you can do this, because that's the only way you can do it with that short notice.
I'll make that motion.
Ask a question. This right here is, this is a charge against the city? Who's gonna be responsible for removing all this debris?
Well, the city will remove it, just like they do any other condemnation, and go against the tax rule, whenever the taxes get paid. Be just like the one y'all talking about while ago, and the other thing, I mean, the city's always initially responsible for the money. You gotta pay somebody to go do it.
So the mayor will be seeking someone to demolish this and do it up?
We've already talked to somebody about it, Mr. Bass has.
Okay, motion.
So the motion's to give 24 hours?
So we need another motion, Mr.?
No, I don't, y'all need to approve the condemnation, we need a motion.
Okay, we need, okay, so.
The 24 hours?
24 hours to remove motion for, to cure, actually to cure the danger to health and safety.
All right, so we have a motion to condemn Anthony Autry property from Miller. Do I hear a second? Second by Mr. Edwards. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I'll get Edward to give you a judgment and we'll see if you can see the same.
Okay, number nine is the authorization for the mayor to execute a contract with Schumer Consulting for ground storage tank replacement. If you look in your packet, there's a budget, ground storage tank replacement budget. We've been talking about this for months because of the State Department DHH pointing us to our above ground storage tank has been leaking for years, and they've written the city up repeatedly about getting that remedied, and we determined, and Mr. Schuler made a presentation at another council meeting months back about the ground storage tank replacement. The council voted on a resolution to make the application for funding for it through the clear water drinking, or the drinking water law program through the state. I had not done that yet. I was hesitant on doing that because I was concerned about the way to pay for it. but we have, with the termination of contract on the tanks that we had, the elevated tanks, that will save the city enough once that's terminated to make the monthly note for this loan. And so we're ready to move forward with this project. So that's, before we do that, we need to get an engineering contract in place. And he's already prepared the application for the loan program. And so.
But we don't have anything in ready to tell us how this loan is going to go.
How the loan is going to go?
I mean, you're saying, go ahead and do a contract. But I don't see where we've already determined how we're going to pay for this.
We did was that in the January meeting? January meeting, we did, we voted and approved a resolution for, to make the application for the loan. And Mr. Schumer was here and went through the loan program then, and how it works. It's the best source of funding that we could get because there's a loan forgiveness as part of it. And we already have something in there. And I've got Mr. Schumer here. If you'd like to ask him some questions about that loan program.
Okay, yeah, I got a question for Mr. Schumer. On this, okay, your loan forgiveness was part of the deal with the state, right?
The drinking water revolving loan fund.
Right. And okay, being that we in non-compliance, we're not eligible for that, right?
The way it works is it's probably a 6-month process. So let's say in a perfect world we got all this done in a week. They wouldn't close the loan if you're out of compliance. Okay. But it's likely a 6-month process. So I understand what you're saying. They will not close the loan and actually give you the money until you're back in compliance.
Right. So that ought to be the first deal we do anyway, basically.
Okay, so but we go ahead through the process and we're working on the process while we're also taking care of our other business. But my question also is, this contract has to be in place, though, before we can even apply for the loan. I mean, before they'll approve the loan.
Sure, because I'm the one that puts all the together.
Right, I know, that's what I'm saying. So that's something they require in the contract.
Mr. Hams, that's for y'all to decide as far as the contract is concerned. The timing for me to get all of this done, the attorneys to do their part, going to the bond commission, the whole nine yards, is probably a 6-month process. So the idea is, I don't want to get into the audit situation. I'm well aware that's dragging up stuff with projects with me and everything else. But I do think it would be a mistake because the word I'm getting is y'all are close. Well, then maybe a month or two. I don't have the latest update. But
okay, look, I don't know where you're getting your words from. You don't mean close.
Okay, but I have no idea about the audit. Fair enough.
That's going to be the key, though, right?
For them to close the loan for this money, you have to be in compliance.
But yes,
if we get loan approval, they'll hold it until we are in compliance and then close it, right?
Sure, but this is a 6-month process.
Is that a requirement that we be in compliance before you apply for this?
Not apply, no, sir. They won't close the loan until you're in compliance. You can apply. There are projects that take far longer than 6 months. Like the Public Service Commission with nonprofit water systems, you got to get a rate increase. That's drug projects out for a year. So I understand what y'all are saying. The truth is, this is a 6-month process no matter what. Instead of you asking about the terms, just to repeat those, it's 20% of what you ask for is principal forgiveness, fancy way of calling it a grant. The balance, the 80%, is 20 years fixed at 2.45%. So those are excellent terms. The other issue is different.
Okay.
So would that increase to $700,000? I mean, being that, I mean, to say if it comes up before we come in compliance, they say, well, it's time for y'all to move now and you're still not in compliance. So that moves the money up, the amount of money that has to be paid, because we're not getting the forgiveness part from the state.
The forgiveness should be there. Again,
I don't want to speculate about the timing of the audit, so, but let's say in 6 months that we're still not there with the audit.
Right.
And we're ready to close, basically, we just sit there and wait. All the paperwork doesn't, it's not like I have to start over. I was giving you the example of water systems, I mean, years with other issues. So the timing with this is 6 months, the audit is what it is. But I don't think that, maybe this is another part of your question. Let's say that it did drag out for a long period of time and maybe the money changed. That contingency, that $24,500 in the budget, that's kind of what that's for, is to, there might be some unknowns. Try to make it into the budget ahead of time. If you don't use it, you give it back.
I recommend that we move forward on faith that we will be back in compliance before this 6 month window or whatever, but rather than wait, because if we wait and we get back in compliance, if it's 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, then that means we'd be another 6 months out potentially on getting all this closed and done. If we go ahead and apply now, hopefully it will all come together at the same time or sooner.
I know what you're saying, Mayor, but I sure like to be in compliance before I start moving forward on all this stuff, because somewhere along the line it's going back on us. We're not in compliance. We have no idea what our situation is financially, because we have to win. I mean, we're 3 years down the arc. From what I understand, the lady told me that we're in deep crap.
What are we out at the moment? What are we out if we go ahead and authorize this and move forward? Are we out anything, or if there is a delay, or are we?
The delay doesn't cost anything.
Okay.
So by applying for the application, you're going to spend a certain amount of revenue anyway.
It depends on the timing, and here's why. Has everybody got this in front of them? What's that? You see the part that says system improvement plan, $5,000? Mm-hmm. And you see the part that says business plan support, $5,000? That business plan support does not go to me. It goes to a financial person that basically puts your books together. That's what they, Drinking Water Fund, calls this business plan proof that you can pay back the debt service. Knowing what I know about that contract that y'all, I guess it was last meeting with utility service, I think that's a great idea. That more than paid for this, so that part should be easy. But nonetheless, that would be an expense that you would incur in the application phase. That system improvement plan is there, basically saying an engineering report. That's what my part would be, to get you to the point where they would consider the loan. So if you're wanting kind of what am I into it for, those two for sure would be incurred. Unless it drags out for an extended period of time, I won't treat y'all any different than we treat everybody else. We don't bill anything until the loan closes and I get the money up to that point that I'm due. Does that make sense? So unless the project completely dies, the city wouldn't be directly out those funds. So I know that's a long answer, but it all depends on where you are in the process.
So minimum $10,000.
I would say that's fair. If you got 6 months from now and the whole project blew up and you decided not to do this, then theoretically that money would be due to five to me and five to, I don't know who you are using for accounting work. Does that make sense?
Good. All right. Any other discussion? If not, then we will call for a vote.
So moved.
Have a motion by
second.
Junkin, second by Miller. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? abstentions?
Yeah.
Okay, have Mr. Hams abstains, Mr. Edwards? Did you?
Opposed, no.
Okay, we have three yays, one no, one abstention. Did you get that for the minutes? Okay. The number 10 is Fair Housing Proclamation. This seems like proclamation month. We'll flip over that. Find mine so I can read it. Okay, thank you. Asking for a resolution from the council, whereas the 49th anniversary of the National Fair Housing Law, Title 8 of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, during the month of April, is an occasion for all Americans individually and collectively to rededicate themselves to the principle of freedom from housing discrimination wherever it exists. And whereas the law guarantees for each citizen the critical personal element of freely choosing a home, and whereas a fair housing law has been passed by the state of Louisiana, and implementation of the law requires the positive commitment, involvement, and support of each of our citizens. And whereas barriers that diminish the rights and limit the options of any citizen to freely choose a home will ultimately diminish the rights and limit the options of all. Now, therefore, the mayor and the city council of the city of Winnfield do hereby resolve and proclaim the month of April 2017 as Fair Housing Month. Do I need a motion for that, Mr. Attorney? For that?
Yeah.
Need a resolution to declare April as Fair Housing Month. Have a motion by Demery. Second by Junkin. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries. Next is the National Community Development Week resolution. Thank you. This is, we were asked to do this as by the LCDBG block grant program. And so this resolution reads, whereas that the week of April the 17th through April 22nd, 2017 has been designated as National Community Development Week. The city of Winnfield has been a participant in the Community Development Block Grant Program, which funds public infrastructure, economic development, and housing programs in this community. And whereas in this community and communities throughout the nation, 35 years of community development block grant program funding has developed a strong relationship between this local government and its residents, principally those of low to moderate income. And whereas this community recognizes that the community development block grant is a partnership of federal, state, and local government and community and business efforts, and that the services funded by the CDBG program relies heavily on the dedication and goodwill of our combined efforts. Therefore, be it resolved that during the National Community Development Week 2017, this community will give special thanks and recognition to all participants whose hard work and devotion to the neighborhoods and their low and moderate residents help ensure the quality and effectiveness of the Community Development Block Grant Program. And be it further resolved that this community, along with the service providers and others whose names are appended to this resolution, hereby petition the U.S. Congress and administration to recognize the outstanding work being done locally and nationally by the Community Development Block Grant Program and its vital importance to the community and the people who live in its lower income neighborhoods. And be it further resolved that the copies of this resolution be conveyed to the appropriate elected and appointed officials of the federal government, and that this community's name be added to the roll of those committed to the preservation and full funding of the Community Development Block Grant Program and maintenance of its essential features over the course of the next session of Congress. The above resolution has been read in full and the vote taken was adopted on the 11th day of April 2017. So do I have a motion to adopt this resolution declaring the week April 17th and April 22nd as National Community Development Week in Winnfield? Have a motion by Devery. Second by Mr. Edwards. All in favor, say aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, one more resolution. The internet tax resolution. This is a resolution urging the United States Congress to enact legislation that will enable local governments to collect revenues already due that are essential to the maintenance and expansion of local government and regional economies, the creation of thousands of new jobs, and the enhancement of quality of life and preservation of limited local revenue sources. Whereas many local governments rely on the collection of sales and use taxes to support funding to improve needed infrastructure improvements, strengthen local small businesses, create jobs for their citizens, and fund essential services. Whereas local brick and mortar merchants are important parts of our communities, providing employment to residents, contributing to charities, and keeping communities vibrant. And whereas the Supreme Court has previously ruled that the state and local governments do not have authority to require the collection of sales tax by retailers that have no physical presence or nexus in the state. And whereas the Supreme Court precedent puts local merchants at an automatic 5 to 10% competitive disadvantage by following the law and collecting sales tax at the time of purchase, while remote online retailers are not required to do so. Whereas national studies reveal that the state and local governments lose up to $30 billion each year from uncollected sales taxes from transactions involving remote internet retailers. Whereas the internet sales tax revenue could be utilized to better provide basic services, improve infrastructure, and bolster public safety, all without any additional funding from the federal government. And whereas the federal government has been historically reluctant to interfere with the ability of local governments to raise and regulate their own revenues and should not undermine municipal authority with respect to remote sales tax collection. And whereas the technology has evolved to the point that moving the Marketplace Fairness Act and other legislation forward to allow the collection or remittance of destination rate-based sales taxes on internet transactions is not only practical but warranted. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City of Winnfield commends Congress on recognizing the importance of resolving the issue to put remote retailers and traditional ones on a level playing field. Be it further resolved that the City of Winnfield urges Congress to pass destination-based legislation that would give states the option to collect from remote online retailers the same tax that local brick-and-mortar merchants currently collect. Be it further resolved that copies of this resolution shall be transmitted to the Louisiana Congressional Delegation, as well as the Honorable Paul Ryan, Speaker of the House, United States Representative, Honorable Bob Goodlatte, Chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, and Honorable Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader. So,
let me ask you a question, man. Do we have any way of collecting this? Would it cost us? Would it set us some capital bill? I saw something on the news about it.
I hope it will be collected just like our current sales tax is collected through the school board.
If I can interject, Amazon actually is now currently collecting local sales tax, and we are benefiting from that. It's being collected by the school board's office as our regular sales tax is, and then transferred to us on a monthly basis. So
it has the copy where the how much fund coming from the end of the year.
The school board office has how much is coming from Amazon, but they started collecting that in January. But if you go to Amazon now and try to buy something, you're going to pay 10.5%, just like you would if you went to Walmart.
Okay. So, do I have a motion on the internet sales tax resolution? Mm-hmm. I have a motion by Mr. Edwards.
Second.
Second by Ms. Demery. All in favor, say aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, number 13, creation of a training officer designation for the Fire Department Civil Service, Chief Montgomery.
Mayor and Council. On behalf of the Winnfield Fire Department, I'm here to make a request for the City Council for the purpose of the creation of the position of training officer classification in civil service for the purpose of focused demands that have been recently placed upon not only our department, but departments statewide. Training officer will be tasked with the responsibilities of all activities that are required to maintain and promote an effective training program for the members of Winnfield Fire Department. The Office of the State Examiner provides steps to follow to create the new position. Step one is that the governing authority, which is the City Council, will first approve the creation of this new position. And then following is an 11-step process involving the Office of the State Examiner, the Fire Department, and the Winnfield Municipal Fire and Civil Police Civil Service Board. As the Fire Chief, it's my recommendation and request that the City Council create this new position of Fire Department Training Officer. Since new regulations have come effective January the 1st of 2017, there's been an increase of the demands on training for Fire Department personnel, and not only the time that we put in the training program, but also the record keeping of it, so that we facilitate in being able to have a designated person to take care of those focused responsibilities. For instance, training facilities, which I might mention here, is a good time to mention that, along with conjunction with the Fire District 3 and the help with the police jury, and are also our district attorney who's working on the conveyance for the old Chris Oak plant site. That property is going to be donated to the Fire Department District so that we could develop it into a training facility, which actually adds to 35% of our training rate. For instance, 18 hours a year training facility time has to be put in, 16 hours a month of company training, multi-company training, independent study, night and day drills, 12 hours a year for officer training, 60 hours a year for new driver operator training, 12 hours a year existing training for driver operator, 6 hours a year for hazmat, 240 hours a year for new recruit, and then our 40 hours a year for EMS recertification along with other certifications that are required. All of this benefits the city in respect to the fire rating, which I'll be bringing some of that up in the next session. But my request to the city is to begin this process, which is no sooner than 3 months, and may take up to 5 months for the process, because what happens is the Office of State Examiner, after they have the approval of the City Council to create this position, which can be internally, that the questionnaire is sent to me, we fill out the questionnaire, they create a test in order to, it's a competitive test where they can create a test to give a civil service exam, and then once that exam is passed, then that position can be permanently filled. So that's my request tonight concerning training officer.
Is this going to be a current fireman, I guess, that you have already?
Yes, ma'am.
It wouldn't be a new position to hire a new person for.
It can work either way. It can come from internally. Because training officer is a designated competitive exam, it's not classified as promotional, which promotional means it has to come within the department. Competitive means it's just like an entry level. Others from the outside can also apply. Our goal here is not to create a position so much as it is for the benefit of hiring on another person, as much as it is allowing that position to be created to designate someone within our department to take care of those responsibilities. However, it can work either way.
So what you're saying is that you can take somebody from within the department and train them and have them set them up to be trained, then
yes,
come back?
Yes, sir. And we do have those that meet the minimum criteria to be able to apply for this position.
And they have to pass a test.
Yes, sir, they do. We can make provisional appointments before this is completed so that those assignments can be assigned to a particular individual to start the process. and then, of course, whoever that is and others can have to take the test and pass it.
Now, we currently, for this type of training, send our, you send everyone off somewhere else if they're going to get...
Well, in the past, as far as the new recruit academies, whenever they're available, they're not as available as they used to be anymore. They're rather expensive as well. We do a lot of internal training. LSU fireman training comes in to our parish twice a month. We utilize their training as well as joint training with the parish and fire department when they're out there as well. So we try to utilize all the resources that are available to us.
That's currently, but this would alleviate some of the necessity of going outside somewhere to get someone else.
Well, as it is right now, under the new regulations, which I'll get into a little bit more here shortly, but there are things that we've been doing in the past as far as training do not even count now under these new schedules. So having a training officer will help in two respects. Number one, it will designate someone to take care of these responsibilities. And number two, it'll staff us with another officer, which is part of the requirements to have officers on each shift.
Okay. Any other questions before we ask for the vote? Okay. Not, I'll ask for the vote on the creation of a training officer designation.
You have a motion to second.
Pardon?
You have a motion to second.
That's right, I have a motion. I'm getting my cart ahead of the horse.
I'm making the motion.
Okay, I have a motion by Mr. Hams. Second by Ms. Demery. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. That's okay. Don't go anywhere, Chief. You're next. That concludes that section of the agenda. Now we move to new business, non-action. And the first thing on here is the fire rating presentation by Chief Montgomery.
Yes, sir. Again, I appreciate the council giving me an opportunity to share some facts with, so that it'll help further your knowledge about the fire rating schedule. And that's the goal here. I've given a couple of leaflets to you. One of them is going to be labeled the fire suppression rating schedule. And I'm going to try to cram as much information as I can over the next few minutes so that it'll give all of you hopefully a better understanding of what the demands and the changes are effective January the 1st of 2017. The objective is to share facts of the fire suppression rating schedule in hopes of increasing the knowledge of and encouraging proactive steps that can be taken in order to help advance and also maintain a current fire rating. As it is right now, the city enjoys a Class 3 fire rating, which is an exceptional fire rating for a city of our size. The purpose of this schedule is to outline the criteria for evaluating the fire prevention and fire suppression capabilities of individual communities or fire protection areas. The purpose of such an evaluation is to develop a public protection classification for property insurance ratings. What that means is insurance companies use this schedule to be able to rate their community on the fire protection capabilities, and that determines in a great part of how much they charge homeowners and businesses for their fire protection insurance. The scope of this is the schedule measures the majority elements of the fire protection area's fire prevention and fire suppression systems. The fire suppression component evaluates those systems address reported structure fires, and it's based on structure fire calls. The schedule gives procedures and formulas for developing the measurements into a public protection classification number on a relative scale from 1 to 10, 10 being the less than minimum recognized protection. So the lower the number of classification, the better that rating that the insurance rating is going to affect their insurance rating. Just to give you a few fire department stats on the bottom of that particular sheet, over the past few years, in 2013, our call volume was 198 calls that we responded to. 2014, it increased by almost 100 calls to 292. 2015, it nearly doubled to 540. And in 2016, we responded to 567 calls. And of that, 433, which is 77%, were EMS-related calls. To date of 2017, We have already responded to 135 calls and projected to close to 600 calls for this year. The reason I mention those statistics is to bring to our awareness the increased demand of fire department services. Over the past couple of years, the fire department has been responding to EMS calls. Those EMS calls actually have no bearing on our fire rating schedule at all. It doesn't add to or take away whatsoever. It is a service that the city has been providing, or the department's been providing to the city. I've asked Mr. Peters with the advance to share a few comments with you just to interact about how the fire department has been impacting the positive way in our community.
Well, thank you, Mayor, member of the city council. I've been working in EMS for 25 years, rural EMS. I've been from one end of the spectrum to the other as far as owners, and now I'm a supervisor here in Winnfield for Advance. The fire department responding to emergencies here, there's a lot of towns that's not your size, that's bigger than y'all are, that don't even have that luxury. As I said, I'm experienced in rural EMS. Most of the time, we got two trucks sitting over there and nothing's going on. Sometimes, we got a truck in Ruston, we got a truck in Alexandria. The fire, and that's where the fire department comes in. I mean, the chief is, with y'all's blessing, y'all have some trained EMTs here now. Your level of care as far as your fire department has increased. It is a vital thing for us to have them on hand because sometimes they beat us to calls and they already have the patient assessed and we don't have to waste that time because, I mean, the more time you spend on an emergency call, if it's something serious, the more time you spend on scene, your outcomes are not as good. And as I said, these guys have been trained up. It helps us a lot because, I mean, you do have medical here. If the hospital does send us in two different directions, y'all still got your guys on the fire department that can tend to people. Now, we do have a mutual aid agreement, and we have trucks posted that comes into the area. But those few minutes sometimes can be a life-saving thing. And I think it's a tremendous asset, and the city council and all the people here in Winnfield ought to be proud to have that. Because, like as I said a while ago, there's a lot of cities bigger than y'all that don't even have that convenience. And it's a good thing to see those guys. I mean, we have troublesome patients sometimes. We have some large patients sometimes. National statistic, 37% of us are overweight. So, I mean, extra help, it's just an essential thing that y'all have here. And I think, in my opinion, I work in seven rural parishes, and I wish I would have had it everywhere else I was. I was interested in the municipality. And the fire chief and those guys that work for him, they're just like, and they feel the same way that I do. We want to do the very best for the citizens of Lynn Parish. And I thank y'all for that.
Thank you.
On the second part of that first sheet, you'll see a scale such as this can also be there. What this is the fire service rating schedule. The left column is actually what the scale was previous to January the 1st. The right scale on the right side column is going to be the new revised schedule. I highlighted a few areas that I want to bring to your attention because in the three areas you have number one is the receiving and handling firearms. This is going to be our communication dispatch area. It's worth 10 points. It's on a 100-point schedule. 10 points of that is handling emergency calls. 50% is of the 100% equation is the fire department. And then the bottom part is the water supply, and that applies for 40%. There's a few things that's been changed since July 1st that demands our attention. And the reason they demand our attention is because if we can be proactive in trying to accommodate to these changes, then not only can we maintain our current rating of 3, but we can work to help to improve that rating if all possible. The first one in the telecommunications area of emergency communications on item number 422, you'll notice that it changed from operators to telecommunicators. What that means is now it's increased also from a 3 to a 4. What that means is our dispatchers now are going to be required to be certified telecommunicators. Not only are they going to be certified telecommunicators, but under the Association of Public Safety Commissions Officials, there's another second step of certification they'll be required to have. So that's just one part there. If we skip down to the water department, briefly, you'll see that there's a couple of line items, number 621, that's gone from a 2 to a 3. This deals with our hydrant sizes and what they're capable of flowing in our water system. And then the biggest change is going to be line item 631, which has gone from a 3 to a 7. And what that entails is inspections and fire flows and gauging of the fire hydrants, which currently the fire department handles that once a year. Then, of course, the fire department columns, that's the middle columns. That's the biggest part of the fire rating, 50%. You'll notice that line 513 deals with engine companies. It went from a 10 to a 6. What this means is this particular category deals with what equipment we have as far as apparatus, responding units, and then what equipment's on those apparatus. We're governed by national fire protection agencies on what we're supposed to have on those pieces of equipment. And used to, these points could pretty much be bought. You just buy the equipment, put it on there. There's been a shift of the burden of these points from that line. If you go down to line 561, the old schedule called the distribution of companies. The new schedule calls it deployment analysis. You'll notice it went from 4 to a 10. The burden has been shifted there, and it's not equipment now so much that they're concerned with. Okay, we know you have your equipment. What we want to know is how you get your equipment to the scene. And this is an area that demands personnel. This is where a big shift is. The next line item 571, is personnel. You'll notice that out of 50, that is 15 plus points of the 50. That deals with the number of people that you have on duty that respond to the calls. And then the next item being 581 is the training, which is it's a 9. Those three items alone count for 34, which is 70% of the total 50 that the fire department generates in this fire rating. All three of those are directly involving personnel, and they completely affect how those scores are generated. Now, the reason that's important is, and what I'm trying to propose to this council is that in order for us to be able to maintain the rating that we have now, which I provided all of you, the most recent rating from the Property Insurance Association of Louisiana. This is the actual subclassification details that are sent back to us after rating is done. It was done in 2015. Our next rating will be in 2020. We'll be graded on years 2017, 18, and 19. This year, next year, and the following year. You'll notice the first page deals with dispatching, receiving, handling calls. Again, number 2 deals with that classification has been changed to a 4 instead of a 3. That deals with the certifications of our dispatchers. Page number 2, the fire department. Line number 6, there again, credit for distribution. This is the big increase from a 4 to a 10. Which means that all of this is due to item reviews, a percent of built upon area, which is adequately equipped, responding first to engine company within a mile and a half. What this is, and there's a book full of stuff you can read if you're interested in it, there's formulas that are figured up, and they regulate us on how much time it takes us to get our first engine to the scene, how much time it takes the second engine to get to the scene, and the aero apparatus. There's not a piece of equipment down at that fire department that we're not required to have. Everything we have, the rating schedule says we've got to have it to enjoy the rating that we have. They require that we roll 2 engines and an aero apparatus on every structure call. The only way we can get them there is we have to have personnel to do it. What hurts us now is if we've got a shift with one man on duty, he carries the first apparatus out. We've got to wait for responding personnel to come back and get it. Where that hurts us is in the time factor, and all that plays into our equation. Item number 7, you'll see it's our biggest deficiency. Credit for company personnel, out of a total of 15-plus points, the city obtained 1.68 points. The reason for that is just simply that. There are times, we've got four shifts, two of those shifts have one man per shift. The other two has two people per shift. Turning over the next page, the last, page number three, credit for training. There again, this is another deficiency that we have. Out of nine possible points, we got 4.37. With the addition of the training facility, which adds 35% of that part of that grading, it's going to help increase that. With the addition of a training officer that fulfills some of that responsibility of keeping them records, we're hoping to be able to accumulate all 9 points there. And then finally down in the water supply, you'll see where there was a change there as well. On the last page, it deals with what our total score was for the city rating, 70.09%. If you look on the classification mid-page, you'll see 70.9% is exactly 1 point away from being a class four. That's how close the city is to going to a class four. My proposition to the council is this, is that if we choose that we want to try to enjoy and keep a class three as a minimum, then as fire chief, I would request that we look at all avenues possible to be able to move toward the additional two personnel that we need in the fire department to staff two men per shift. This is going to increase our budget, I know, and I realize that this is a big issue for everybody. But we've worked very hard to try to maintain our budget in the fire department, do what we can to cut corners everywhere we can. But you can see by this rating schedule, and I'll be glad to take any questions that you have, that the three biggest hits involve personnel. The only way that we can make up the difference is to try to add those people, two additional people, so that we can maintain that personnel response. I'll be glad to take any questions that you might have.
How many part-time people to equal one?
The change in classification is this, and I'll give this a brief example. Before January the 1st, if you were a full-time paid man and you responded to the call, then you got counted as one man. Now it's been changed to on-duty, off-duty. If you're on-duty, you get counted as one person. If you're off-duty, even though you're paid part-time or volunteer, the ratio is three. It takes three responding off-duty persons to equal one responding person. So that's the ratio now. In the equation that helps to figure this, the only thing that does not have a deduction in the equation is the on-duty personnel. Everything else has some kind of deduction to it. But when you look at the equation, the algebra equation that they use to figure this, on-duty personnel is the only thing that counts as a whole by itself.
Is that on-duty full-time or on-duty?
On-duty, period. Yeah, whether they're full-time or part-time, it matters not as whether they're full-time or part-time. Mm-hmm. It just matters that they're on-duty.
This rating schedule, it's graded over a three-year period. Is that correct?
Yes. Municipality is graded every 5 years. They're graded on the three previous years prior to the grading year, which our grading year, they'll send us a packet in late 2019, which we'll start filling out. It'll end December 31st, 2019, and then somewhere around March or April, they'll come in and do a grading in 2020. And it'll be on 2017, which we're in right now, 18-19. That's where we're at.
So what you're saying, we have all the equipment we need, we just don't have the manpower.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We have everything that we could purchase equipment-wise to help satisfy the rating demands. And then, therefore, they adjusted the burden from, okay, no longer can you buy the points. We're going to give you credit for it, but now we want to see how you're getting that equipment there. And it all factors into the response times and so forth. I'll be glad the office is open, you know, during the week if you want to come down and sit down and talk. you have any other questions about it, I appreciate your interest in it. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you. New business, non-action number two, Mr. Hams.
Okay, well, everybody up here is a public servant, if I start like that, and sometimes you'll get criticized, you're gonna get tough topics, you're gonna, so we gotta be able to answer the issues when they come up, I mean, as a group, you know, and if we can't do that, I guess we in the wrong business. Okay, the reason I put the pay raises on the agenda is because of the full council is something that we need to discuss, because there's been some raises given and there's been questions about it, and I think it's time for the public to receive answers about it. Okay. One of our primary duties as the council is to make sure we utilize taxpayers' money as wise and efficient as possible. You know, sometimes it happens, sometimes it don't happen, but that's one of our primary duties. Okay, during our fiscal years when we pass budget, that's what we utilize during the city for the year. Okay, during the prior to this budget being passed, it was stated by our mayor that we didn't have any money for raises. So that's what we told our employer, that you won't get a raise this year because, you know, we don't have any funding for it. But during the process, we find out through public record that some employees receive raises, you know, and so therefore I say, well, it's a question that the entire council needs to answer, you know, not just, well, I didn't receive a lot of questions about it, you know, I don't have all the answers, so I say if we get up here as a group, maybe we can answer some of the questions, you know, so during our budget time, we have to make sure that we pass it to make sure that's what governs the mayor's day-to-day operation. Once we pass the budget, it's on the mayor to govern that day-to-day operation for the entire year. So that's what we expect him to do. That's what the citizens expect him to do. You know, so when I was asked, though, why did some people get raises, I told them, well, wait, come to the council meeting. I asked the question myself. You know. I don't have all the answers. But I do expect the council as a group, as well as the mayor, to answer some of these questions so we can move forward, you know. So some of the raises was given on 10/16, three individuals, dollar piece. I had no knowledge of it. We discussed it briefly we didn't want to discuss it with some of the answers I got. Come 1/17 January, three more individuals given a raise, ranging from $1 to $3. I'm like, well, this got to be discussed, you know. So my question is to the council as a group, you know, like, we need to answer some questions. If you have a question for me, I answer. But myself, I'm going to ask some questions first. Like I say, and I'm going to ask, I guess I stole Council Lady Junk. I mean, Denver, do you think it was fair for these individuals to get raises and not everybody?
Not just individuals, we need to look at it, as a whole. And I'm not saying maybe give everybody a dollar raise, but I do think the city employees should get a raise at least once a year.
Okay. So I ask, I guess, Ms. Junkin, were you aware that any of these employees received a raise prior to them getting it? They was going to get one?
But I agree with exactly what Ms. Demery said.
Okay. I'll take that. Mr. Miller, do you approve the way these raises was given? I mean, as far as...
I would need to know more about the particular circumstances of each individual, but, you know, I want all the employees to have raises, of course.
And I agree with that. See, and that's our job as a council, to make sure we know. And right now, we're not knowing. The raises are being given, then we find out after the fact. And that's the problem. That's the part I have a problem with. Mr. Elwood, did you observe any of the morale of the workers that you visited with?
It's probably at its lowest point. And the reason for that is probably because of the information we got from the mayor, and that we didn't have any money to give these raises. And we made that during Christmas time, during the time back then, we give out these 25-cent raises or whatever it might be. So we went on with the program with that. the next thing I know, that wasn't true, that was not factual, it was just something that was going down with certain employees. And then I looked at some employees that we gave raises to, I have no problem with that. But I looked at some of them that wasn't giving raises, that's doing two or three jobs. So that really, you know, you create morale problem, that just pretty much killed it right there. Right now, morale problem in our city, without employees, are just probably zero. They don't have any faith, and they don't have any trust in what comes out of the administration now.
Well, what I do now, I get a merit opportunity to explain his reasoning behind the raises, because he was the one that gave the raise. So I turn the floor to the mayor, for he can explain himself to us and everybody else, and everybody be on the same page.
I gave these raises because I felt like it's my job as mayor to make sure we have, keep the lights, water, sewer, and those type things on, and that we have the qualified people in the necessary positions to do that and to maintain that. And I gave those raises based on that within my authority as a mayor. And that's my answer. Anytime you do something like that and everybody doesn't get something, sure, everybody thinks maybe they've been treated unfairly. But based on my decision, that's my answer.
But the only thing I said, we didn't put any money in the budget for raises. The budget was passed and approved without raises. And then for that mean money had to be moved from one spot to the other line items because it wasn't there. And that's the part that concerns me, that if it wasn't there for that, it should have been a group effort, not just because that's what you felt. It should have been the entire council, so we could decide, well, we could have moved some of this money as a group, because we the one. Then you come back and want the budget amended, and it would tell you more than the budget amended because it's been some wasteful or overspending somewhere. So if we did that initially, maybe we wouldn't have had to amend the budget.
Well, I've given my answer.
Okay, well, that's all we asked for, man. I'll take that. And everybody here know what it is. That's what we all on the same page. That's what I'm saying.
My other question to Mary is that, so you tell us as a council that you can't give these raises. You can't do this. We go out and tell the same lie to the people out here. So, I mean, wait, you're throwing us under the bus here. And then we all of a sudden these employees come to us and tell us, these people got a raise. Why we get one? But you're the one that told us. And we followed your lead on this. And now all you can tell us is what I decided to do. I think that was a really bad decision on your part. And if I had my way, if I hurt these employees, I'd rescind those raises. And go back to the table and try and give everybody a raise. Okay, I'll just hold off until we do the next budget. I think that's the fair way to do it, instead of putting us out there like that. Because all we did was tell them one big fat lie.
Okay, and I think in conclusion of this here, I think what we need to do as a council, and I hold myself as responsible as the next man, a lady, you know, I think we're going to have to go in and look at our policy. I think me and Ms. Junkin, we are on that board. We've got to look at this policy and see how we can make sure that from this point forward, all employees are treated fairly, you know. So we have to implement whatever we need to implement. I think that's what we need to do. Because, yes, we do allow you to go carry out day-to-day operations, but it's still a guideline. And the passing of the budget guides you to what you're supposed to not do. So that's not just fair to the citizens or the employees, not fair to the council. For us to have to get these questions because it's going behind our back as well. So we need to do this up front. If you got something think you need to do, let everybody be involved in it. Then say, yeah, that's the best idea, and everybody know. So I'm finished with what I have to say.
Okay. Number three, then, electric bonds. That's Mr. Hams.
Well, the only thing I got on that is that to make sure, Susan, did we pay that money that we supposed to pay? We owe somebody $14,000? The ECO?
The substantial completion. Yeah. We had to file a substantial completion. It'll be paid this week at the expiration of the substantial
completion. Okay, then we'll be finished
with it. Finished. Okay. Yes. The bond will be finished.
So we'll have a copy of that check and receipt from that.
Okay, number four, audit update.
I went to see Ryan Johnson and kind of him, and I got a bill formulated, and her exact words to me was, she would try and get the reading of it, whatever she was writing of it, and maybe be here by the end of this week. That was 14 and 15. And asking about 15 and 16, she told me that we have not even received, we don't have 15 and 16. 15 and 16, we're going through the same process as 14 and 15. So we know how long that took. So 15 and 16, well, that's what I was talking to you about, the water situation, the tank. We don't know where we are financially. We don't know where we are. We jumping out here on this boat that's got a big old hole in it, we don't know where we're going. We need, with 3 years of this, it's too much for us to keep on trying to move forward. Financially, without knowing where we are.
Let me clarify something.
Let me finish, okay?
Okay.
Now, I talked to her, I said, what about 16 and 17? She said, well, that's going to be a problem for you. So, I'm looking at the end of the year, maybe, we'll be in compliance.
Okay.
And that's why I was concerned about when we were going to jump up the boat about this tank. Do we really have the funds? Are we going to be, in compliance to do anything? We don't know that. We don't have a clue. Huh?
We are approaching a year and a half late on the 14-15, and should be written up. It's completed other than being written up and reviewed, and then we will have that one. Now, the other one was due December 31st, so we're less than 6 months late on that one. Sheffield and Sheffield, the accounting firm that helped pull all the numbers together for the one that's being written up now, has been working on 15-16, and they do require some more information from us that Susan gathers and supplies to them. And then they, when they get their audit adjustment figures and everything together, they give that to Johnson Thomas Cunningham, and they will start on the 15-16. And then the one, we haven't even finished this year yet, and the purpose of contracting this work with Sheffield and Sheffield that we did several months ago was so that when we end this year on June the 30th, that it won't take but some adjustments in July and August, and then they can hand them the stuff and they can work on the year that we will have just completed, 16 and 17, on a timely basis.
Only question I have, do we know what it is? I mean, is it minutes, invoices, or receipts?
Ms. Kelly will have to answer that.
I mean, what are they looking for now? I mean, are they looking for minutes, invoices, receipts?
They're looking for it as outstanding receivables, and I compiled a spreadsheet for that for Sheffield, and they've been in tax season, so they've been kind of think I'm old as well, and then an outstanding checklist as of June 30th of 2016. So
we pretty much know what they are looking for,
right? And I think this 15-16 has gotten much easier because it didn't have to, what do you want to say, recreate the wheel, where 14-15 they were trying to figure out the accruals that Lawrence had done and go back in and just figure out, how the city worked and where everything went to, so I think 15-16 has gotten much easier for them because they had experience.
So that's the audit update, in that we should have the 14-15 in the next
Is that going to do completion? She's working with her?
Yeah, I included an email she sent on Monday in your packet that just said she was about 75% complete writing.
Writing.
She'd be done this week.
The writing, there's a difference.
The writing
the
is
report.
The book.
The report that goes.
It's got a lot of reporting in that book.
And then it's got to go through two peer reviews, which, so she said she'd give us an update by the end of this week. So I expect to probably have an update by Thursday.
Would you let us know?
Yes.
Yeah, we intend, as soon as we get, or she says she's got it written up, we're gonna call a meeting and let her bring it and present it and to the council. And then hopefully we'll be doing the same thing within a few months after that for 15, 16.
Someone can get it within a month, would you think?
I've been wrong on my prognostication so many times, I hate to make another one, but on 14, 15, she's very, very close. And then just, it's completed other than the writing of the proposal. And then 15, 16, she can't start on until Sheffield gives her the information to start, but Sheffield's still putting everything together to give them, which hopefully that will happen within a few weeks. And then they'll start on that. Okay. That being said, then there's nothing else on our agenda, so do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Motion by Demery.
Second.
Second by Junkin. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Under the noise.